So this evening with me, I have Operation SA and the South African National Bazaar Fund have launched an emergency fundraising drive to assist with essential food items to the vulnerable and destitute during the 21-day national lockdown. This in partnership with the Gauteng Social Services Department. Let's get more on that with anti-crime activist and Operation SA, Yusuf Abramji. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you, Sister Nafisa, and thank you for the opportunity on Salam Media.
Thank you for joining us. We're really glad that you got to, you know, get onto the Nafisa Dango show because it's all about creating positivity. What positive things people are doing during this national lockdown is very important for us because I think what it has taught us is actually to create the support structure, and that's what we're looking at. Tell us a bit about your project and what we've done thus far.
Well, it's difficult to be positive in a situation where the entire world seems to be in a very negative mode. But I think there's a lot of positive that comes out from here. I heard Maulana Dawood Samson yesterday in an interview live on Facebook making the point to say, look at the good out of the COVID-19 virus. First of all the casinos are closed. Secondly, all the bars are closed. All the nightclubs are closed. You are now spending time with your family. You now have more time to spend praying and so on. So there's a lot of good that's coming out of the lockdown. And I think that is why it's important, as we're staying at home, as the majority of people are staying at home, first of all, that we abide by the rules and regulations of the government. We have to save lives, but essential services must continue. And I'm heartened, Nafisa, on a positive note, that a lot of charities, a lot of non-profit organizations are coming out and serving the other people who are in desperate need of help, serving them with what we need to do as humanity. We are talking here of the vulnerable, the weak, the destitute, the senior citizens, the homeless, the people that really need our help. So as the lockdown began, we had discussions with the Gauteng Social Development Department, headed by the acting MEC, Panyada Lesufi, is also our education MEC. And we decided, as the South African National Zakat Fund and Operation SA, to partner with the department. Now, we know from experience, it's dangerous for volunteers to go out. And that is why we left the distribution to the department. On average, we've been distributing about 15 tons of food every day. Thousands of sanitizers and soap bars have gone out. We've raised about 4 million rand worth of aid and food donations. And as the goods coming to the warehouse, for example, today we had several truckloads, the goods go out to various parts of the province, Sedibeng, West Rand, Ekurhuleni, City of Shwane, Johannesburg, the Vaal Triangle. The need is massive. And I'm heartened that the South African Muslim COVID-19 task team have also raised millions of rands. A number of charities have come forward, and it is heartening that we're putting our differences aside. Giving charity and helping people should be no competition. We should all be working together. There's enough space for everyone to work together. So whether you're in Durban, whether you're in Cape Town, whether you're in Polokwane, whether you're in Pretoria, please go out there in a very organized way, in a very disciplined manner, and make sure you have all the necessary permissions and the permits from the municipality or from the provincial government. Let's work within the framework of the law. Everyone is trying to make a difference, which is great, but let's do it very organized. Let's not have duplication and triplication in some cases. Let us go out and help people in need. But I can tell you, as I sit here, and I know we want to focus on the positive, as much as we've helped a few thousand families, the need is massive. And Allah knows what will happen if the lockdown is extended, because many of the vulnerable people who are now unemployed, who don't have jobs, who are sitting at home, they don't know where their next meal is coming from. If the lockdown gets extended for whatever reason, we are going to be in dire straits. It's going to be a very long road ahead. But thousands of people are destitute. Thousands of people need our help. And as our religion teaches us, you know, we've done it with the Syrian drive some years ago. We raised millions of rand. We have to help people in need. Our religion teaches us that. And I'm heartened that the Muslim community specifically have come out once again to the fore. And we have dozens and dozens of dedicated men and women going out there and helping those in need, Nafisa?
Most definitely, but I think it's also about determining which areas to go into. I think a lot of people want to give back. Do you think they should do this in unison with you, or how do they go about doing this?
Well, my advice is, you know, unfortunately, we are focusing our efforts and our energies in Gauteng, where the need is massive as well. I had a number of calls from NGOs from Cape Town, from Pietermaritzburg, from Durban. My advice is mobilize in your community. Work through a registered charity, a registered NPO. Get in touch with your local municipality, disaster management, or the provincial government, and try to work in a very coordinated way. Every part of South Africa, the need is massive. We are getting hundreds of calls every day, people wanting a food pack. Unfortunately, we're trying to see wherever we can help, but the reality is, with the limited resources that we have as civil society, we won't be able to help each and every family, which is very heartbreaking. So if you are a charity, wherever you are, even in Gauteng, just do it in a very coordinated way and try to work with the local city of Johannesburg or city of Shwane or Sedibeng municipality or whichever other municipality you have, and try to see if you can take your aid to people in need, because the need is massive. People want our help, and we're only on day 11 of the lockdown. We still have another 10 days or so to go. It's going to be a long haul.
Almost definitely. And, you know, as we were talking about with the gentleman earlier, that there's a huge call in the impoverished areas. And I think a lot of the times there's many areas that are actually not seen to, because we're not even aware of that fact. And as you were saying, it's important for communities to get involved, because they would know an area that's nearby them that really actually has a need for food distribution as such.
And that's very important, because, you know, no sense going into an area where you know the need is going to be, you don't even know the area, or you don't know your informal settlement and where to help. This evening, I got a call from somebody in Pretoria saying somebody in Lanesia wants help. And I said, put them in touch with Sabri Chisti, for example. They're doing some superb work in that particular area. So every area has, especially our Muslim community, have their charities. They need to mobilize and see wherever they can help. And if we work in that way, I think we'll be able to get more help. If we're going to wait for government, we're going to wait forever. We have to make sure that the aid goes out. Today, I spent a few hours at the central warehouse of the department in Johannesburg. The loads kept on coming in. The loads kept on going out to communities in need. This afternoon, I was with the MEC, Panyaza Lesufi. We went to the Littleton Sports Park in Centurion, where 400 homeless people have been relocated from the Caledonian Stadium. A company donated a massive marquee. Thousands of mattresses were delivered, blankets. Food has to be given three times a day. For example, in Pretoria, we have the young men and women from the Lodium Disaster Management Team that are very active. They're feeding hundreds of homeless people each and every day. They're delivering food parcels to the informal settlements. So if we can use that model, and we take that model to every corner of South Africa, inshallah, we'll be able to make a big difference, and we'll be able to help thousands and thousands of people who are depending on us, Nafisa.
Almost definitely. And what if people would like to actually join you on your drive within your areas?
Well, I think the only way, we're accepting food donations in bulk. My appeal this evening is to especially the wholesalers, the producers, the manufacturers, the farmers, please donate essential food items. I'm talking here of maize meal, I'm talking of rice, I'm talking of oil, I'm talking of tinned foods, cake flour, etc., sugar, tea. The volunteers from the department are now busy packaging many of the bulk products into food hampers, which are then delivered to the very areas. Secondly, we know that people want to donate, whether it is a 1 rand donation, whether it's a 1 million rand. Like one company gave us a donation of 1 million rand. It goes a very long way to helping somebody in need. The South African National Zakat Fund and my dear friend Shoukat Faki, the former Auditor General, is heading up this particular program. He's making sure that the aid reaches the most vulnerable people, those in need. He'll make sure that the procurement procedures are followed, and he's overseeing the entire project, because very often these things can go into the wrong hands, and we have a problem, the aid will not reach the people in need. So we have to make sure that every rand donated, people give it to you in trust, must be well spent. We are not accepting zakat, we are only taking sitka and lila. And alhamdulillah, the response has been good. 3-4 million rand of aid has come in, and we're delivering it to wherever we can. The SANZF bank account details are available on social media, the FNB account. We're also doing crowdfunding. You can go to the SENSEF website and donate there, and you can be assured that every rand donated is going to go a very long way to feed a hungry person. We have a moral responsibility in Nafisa. We have a civic duty to help people in need, and we have to continue to making sure that we help the vulnerable, the people in need during this emergency, during the crisis. And yes, you know, we were all taken by surprise. This has to be an emergency operation because people need our help. I think we've lost a link there, Nafisa.
We actually lost contact was how important is it for us to maybe get in touch with you? Because I think a lot of the NGOs and the NPOs, the fear of going out there with the social distancing and the issues that they face to try and go out and to get those parcels out, would it be actually better to do it via you? Because as you say, you have a structure in place where you then can reach out through the social development, through the government itself. Because a lot of the people are having the constraints where they want to actually go into the area, but they can't.
Yeah, I think that's an important point. You know, I've made the point in a number of media interviews which I had today. This is no competition. It's not one organization trying to outshine the other. We are all in this together. So whether we give our aid to organization A, B, or C, it makes no difference as long as the aid reaches the people in need. So if many of the volunteers, and we can't use volunteers because of the lockdown, they have to have necessary permits and they have to be, and you know, we don't want the situation where people are going to be arrested going out there with a good intention of feeding somebody. I say do it within the framework of the law. So if any NGO, that we've had some of them, I mean, the Caring Women's Forum, Zahira Baum Ismail, her organization donated 500 mattresses. They bought 1,000 blankets, which they delivered to our central depot that went out the weekend to needy communities and to the homeless people. We've had a number of NGOs taking the money, buying stock and delivering it to the central warehouse. If that happens, we're happy to take it on and to make sure that the aid gets reaches the people in need in Gauteng especially. So they're welcome to contact us. I'll give you my WhatsApp number. The easiest is for them to WhatsApp me, and I'll try to respond to everyone. But yes, if NGOs want to come up and partner and donate the items that they've collected or they raised in their community, they're welcome to do that. The only thing is the distribution is going to go to central points across the province. So unless a community NGO wants to focus on a certain area in their neighborhood, they're welcome to do so. But my advice is do it again, very organized, get the necessary permissions, do it within the framework of the law.
Be okay for them to actually maybe get in contact with you and get the necessary protocol, because I think you people would know that best.
Yeah, I mean, to get the necessary protocols is not going to be quite easy. You have to be a registered non-profit organization. That's why I'm suggesting work through a registered NPO, work through somebody that have been an organization that has been doing this type of relief work for a long time. It will make the task very much easier. I mean, we're all trying to make a difference. People are saying, I'm sitting at home, I'm bored, I don't know what to do, can I come and volunteer? Unfortunately, as much as we want people to volunteer, we cannot risk their lives nor the lives of other people by asking them to come out and delivering food hampers. Even when we go out there, we have to take the necessary safety precautions, make sure you have your mask, your gloves, make sure that you follow the protocols and the procedures. And that is why I think the experts who have been doing relief work for a long time will give you the do's and don'ts during such an emergency. And yes, we are learning as we're going along the way. This has been, the lockdown took everyone by surprise. And yes, we are going to make some mistakes as we're going to go on. Social distancing, for example, is a major part of the mechanism that we need to use to avoid the virus spreading. And even today with the homeless people in Centurion, they don't understand the philosophy of social distancing. They're playing football on the soccer pitch. They are sitting in the grandstands, close by to each other. They're holding hands, etc., etc. And I think we have a lot of education to do, because we are now sitting on almost 1,700 people that are positive. 11 people have lost their lives. If this virus continues to spread at the rate it is, unfortunately, the government, in my view, will have no option but to extend this lockdown for another 21 days. And who knows, even for weeks to come, if we're not able to kill the virus. And I think the experts have put it very eloquently, the only way to stop the virus from moving is for you to stay at home. If you have to go to a store, to a grocery store for your essentials, go quickly, come back. If you have to go to the pharmacy, go quickly, come back. Many communities, unfortunately and sadly, are not taking heed. I had calls from across South Africa up to today, 11 days into the lockdown, to say people are not listening. They are walking in the streets. They're having brides. They're visiting family. We don't realize, when you look at the statistics in Europe, in the USA, 8,000 people plus have been killed, have died as a result of the virus in the United States of America. When we look at the figures for the United Kingdom, for Italy, for Spain, it's a total disaster. And if we are not going to take our responsible steps to make sure that we do our bit for the virus not to spread, I think the government has said it, we are going to have a serious crisis on our hands. And at this rate, the virus will only spread. Imagine if we have millions of people in our informal settlements, people with underlying medical conditions being infected. We are going to have a serious problem. But again, you know, I think we need to pay tribute, Nafisa, not only to our charities that are doing superb work. We need to pay tribute to our doctors, our nurses, our paramedics, people in the front line, people that are going out there trying to save lives, people that are taking care of the COVID-positive patients in hospitals or in care centers. And just follow the rules. And I think an academic from the University of Witwatersrand said it yesterday, test, test, and test. And I'm happy that the Gift of the Givers, for example, have set up a number of mobile test stations in Johannesburg, one in Cape Town, one in coming to Pretoria. We just have to make sure that we have to do whatever we have to do to fight this virus from not spreading.
You know, another thing that actually I think concerns everybody is the fact that, you know, the people in the impoverished areas, as you were saying, you know, some of them don't have access to food. So if we can actually get it out to them, it is going to keep them in lockdown. I think a lot of them are coming out having to look for that food that they don't seem to get every other day.
Yeah, indeed. You know, it's not easy. You know, when a person is on a pension or a grant of what, just under 1,000 or over 1,000 rand per month, what can you buy with that kind of money to feed a family of four or five people is basically nothing. A food hamper, for example, goes for about 300 or 400 rand. It might not even last for about 4 or 5 days. So the need is massive, and that is why I'm again calling on the government to release money from the Solidarity Fund. They've got over 2 billion rand for food relief as a matter of urgency. I'm happy that a number of NGOs, a number of prominent South Africans have made the call for an urgent food security program, and I think government will have to move at speed. You know, forget the COVID virus for a moment. Imagine the disaster we'll have if people are going to die of hunger. People have been laid off work. People are not getting their weekly wages or their monthly salaries. People are really finding it difficult. And, you know, as much as we say that there's some positive news in terms of the fight against crime, the Minister of Police said it, that the crime statistics have gone down dramatically since the lockdown began, which is a good sign because of the police visibility. And that is why, you know, we have to look at the broader picture here, but the main focus for now, Nafisa, in my view, is to make sure that we abide by the lockdown rules. Don't be brave. If you are not an essential worker, if you're not going out there to help and you don't have the necessary permits, you've got no business to be out, please stay at home.
Yeah, because, you know, as you're saying, the social distancing and the, we're trying to flatten that curve. I mean, if we don't abide by the rules, then that's not going to happen. And we're going to find that it's going to be just a whole domino effect. And the people in the impoverished areas are really going to suffer a lot more than they are already.
Yeah, I think that's going to be our big challenge. Let's not forget that the conditions millions of South Africans live under are very, very difficult. You talk of social distancing. When one shack is on top of the other shack in areas like Diepsloot, Alexandra Township, Khayelitsha, other parts of South Africa, it's very, very difficult to have the social distancing. In many of the areas, there's no fresh running water. And, you know, we say, wash your hands every now and then for 20 seconds. What do people do when they don't have access to water? So the Department of Water, from what we are seeing, is trying to bring in tankers in many of the areas. We have to promote the philosophy of personal hygiene, washing your hands for at least 20 seconds with a soap bar, which is more effective sometimes than a hand sanitizer, will go a very, very long way. I know people are crying out for masks. They're crying out for gloves. A lot of charities have come forward. The Shout Foundation is now collecting money to distribute thousands of gloves to people in the front line. We have to do our bit. And that is why we also, as citizens, Nafisa, have to act responsibly. We've seen the queues at our supermarkets, at the grocery stores. What is the need for having all the madness and the stockpiling when these supermarkets are going to remain open? So I think we also need to be very, very responsible. And you know what? Let's not be selfish. Let's not make it difficult for other people. Let's just make sure that we go out there responsibly. Don't look for a reason to go out and queue outside the supermarket. Just pace yourself for the next few days. And you know what? In the unlikely or the likely event of the lockdown being extended, we have no other option but to extend it, to accept it, and to work at the rules with the rules and regulations of the government, because government's first priority is to save lives. Because if we're not going to save lives, we are going to be facing thousands and thousands of people sadly losing their lives at the rate that some of our communities are behaving.
Well, definitely. But don't you think it's also like you were saying earlier about the education? Because I think a lot of the people in the township don't understand fully why they are locked down.
Yes, I think education and information is critical. I'm happy that government is starting to send out messages in the various official languages. We have to make sure that these messages reach the people right on the ground level. And yes, I think slowly the messages are going out, but a lot of people do not realize the importance of social distancing, because they've grown up in communities where the word social distancing was nothing, meant nothing for them. So everyone have to become used to it. I mean, even in our religion, it's a sunnah of our beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam for us to shake hands. But now, for a reason, we should not be shaking hands. I know there's been a lot of controversy and debates about whether the mosque should be closed, etc. We have to follow procedures. I mean, even before the lockdown, when government said that there shouldn't be a gathering of more than 100 people, when I asked the question as to whether the annual gathering, the Ijtima in Azadville, is going to continue, I was lambasted by people to say, what right do you have to ask whether the Ijtima is going to be closed or not? Leave the people, let them carry on with the gathering. And we saw what happened in Pakistan, we saw what happened in India. When, for example, some of the Darul Ulums didn't follow the procedures and the recommendations at the time, I raised it publicly, I faced abuse, I faced threats. And I think the people that faced that the victims, the people that made these abusive phone calls to me and messages, don't only owe themselves an apology, they owe the South African public an apology, because we did it with the intention of saving lives. We've got no other intention. I mean, who would like to see a masjid or a Darul Ulum be closed? But the recommendation from the experts shows that the crowds are a problem, and we have to accept it. We have no other option. I know many members of the Muslim community are asking, well, are we able to make Taraweeh during the holy month of Ramadan in our masajid? I mean, I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine. We have to wait and take it day by day, because we are not going to flatten that curve. If the numbers are not going to come down over the next few days, government will have no other option but to extend the lockdown, which is going to be very unfortunate. But if it is there to save lives, we'll have to abide by this. And that is why I think it is quite irresponsible for certain organizations and individuals to call for the mosque to be open under these circumstances. And I think the Jamiatul Ulama South Africa, the Muslim Judicial Council and other bodies are correctly so to say, please, let's cooperate with government, let's follow the rules and the procedures, let's not be irresponsible here.
As you were saying, it's all about flattening the curve, and the government and all these other NPOs that are suggesting that we stay lockdown is literally just looking after the citizens of South Africa, and it's about getting that virus, curbing it and getting rid of it.
Indeed, we have to do whatever it takes, aside from staying at home, aside from the personal hygiene. That is why we as humanitarians are going out there to make sure that we try to help a few people, as many as we can during this time of the stress. We know that feeding is important. We know the poverty levels in our country is very, very high. And we know this is not only a South African problem. I don't think there's one single country in the world that's not been affected by the COVID-19 virus. Government can do so much, but we'll have to support them, we'll have to work with them. And as much as sometimes we criticize government, we have a responsibility, not only as human beings, but particularly as Muslims, to make sure that we help people in need. And that is why I'm saying whatever help we can do, we have to continue doing and see what a difference we can make in our communities, Nafisa.
Oh, most definitely. And it's about uplifting those people. And I think this has been a time, and as I said to you earlier, positive from the sense of reflection. So it made us reflect and ask ourselves, what is it that we are giving back? How are we giving back? What are we doing to uplift somebody else besides ourselves and to obviously be selfless?
And I think very importantly, we also... What are we doing to sit at home? I mean, many people are telling me they're getting bored, their stress levels are up. We've seen domestic violence cases increasing during this time. But I think what you need to do is to, with technology, you know, just raise somebody's spirits. Pick up the phone a family member, phone a friend. How are you doing? Hope you're safe. Do you need anything? Not only people in South Africa, but people across the world. And a quick WhatsApp message or a text message can really make somebody's day. And I think this is a time where we can come closer together as family, as friends, as a Muslim community also, because very often people are sitting at home and saying, I'm bored. Well, use the time constructively, not only to pray, but to also get closer to our Creator, because, there's a lot of time that people now have. People are sitting at home. They say you can't even walk in your estate or outside your house, so you can perhaps walk in your garden. But I think if we can come up with a plan to keep people busy at home, it will go a very, very long way. And also, you know, it will take you a few minutes if you have the means to donate to any of the charitable causes. Please just take your phone, take your app, donate a few rand, and you can be assured that it will give you, you'll feel a bit better knowing that your few rand is going to help somebody in need. And again, I appeal to our business community tonight. Please, we're making money every day through our businesses. Yes, many of them are now closed, but if you have the means and you can afford it, please think of the underprivileged and make a donation.
And you know, the three words that always come into my head during this lockdown is the first word is reflect. Retrospect, and of course, reconnect. And when I say reconnect, I mean, you were just saying the right thing, guys. Reconnect with your Creator, reconnect spiritually, reconnect with your family, reconnect with your inner self, and ask yourself where you are and where you would like to head to as far as giving back is concerned as well. Because as I said, we all have a purpose in this world. And I think one of our major purposes is also to help others and to give that selfless.
Indeed, our religion teaches us when the right hand gives, the left hand mustn't know. But people often ask us, why are you doing all the interviews? First of all, I think we need to place on record that whatever we do, we must do it with sincerity and with passion and with honesty and with the intention of giving sitka. But I think our ulama on record is saying that there is a case where if the right hand gives, the left hand can know, to spur more people on, to donate and more people to do good. That is why we of the view that the more feedback we give to make sure that your rand is being well spent, if we can inspire one person, for example, through your broadcast tonight, just to think, to say, you know what, let me go and donate or let me do an act of kindness in one or other way, I think we would have succeeded. You know, the government talks of active citizenry in the National Development Plan. How do I become an active citizen? How do you become an active citizen? We have to take the lead. Don't depend on your family members. Don't depend on your friends. You take the lead. And, you know, we spend thousands of rand every month on luxuries. Maybe just cut down a few rand this month and say, you know what, I'll rather donate it to somebody in need. Instead of having a three-course meal, let's scale down to a one-course meal tonight and make sure that we give that balance of the food through donations to somebody in need. I think in that way, not only will we be promoting our religion and giving charity, which is a great reward in our religion, but also it will be showing the true spirit of Ubuntu, because we're living in this most southern tip of Africa, and we cannot ignore the plight of our fellow brothers and sisters who are just living down the road in conditions that are very, very poor, with no running water, with poor sanitary conditions. people don't know what is going to be the next day like. And we have a duty to see if we can make a difference and see how we can help them.
It's better to give than to receive.
Indeed, giving has got great reward. And I'm happy that, there are so many organizations, too many to mention on your particular show here. Everyone from the Al-Imdad Foundation, the South African National Zakat Fund, the Caring Women's Forum, individuals I can mention in their thousands, the Jamiatul Ulama, the MJC, the list goes on and on and on. To all these organizations, I say to you, I salute you. Please continue to serve your communities. Continue to do good. And I think it holds our religion and our Muslim community in good stead because, again, it's heartening to see Muslims being in the forefront of trying to help the underprivileged and people in need.
Almost definitely, and the Salaam Foundation has also been doing a lot from our side here, and it makes you feel good because in yourself, you know that you're giving back in some way.
Well, on that note, my apologies. I wanted to mention the Salaam Media Foundation and the great work being done by Azhar Vadi and your entire team there, not only now during the COVID-19. I mean, your media platform aims correctly so to promote humanity and humanitarian efforts. And it's something that we need. I mean, the media has a very important role to play, but the media also needs to make sure that we highlight the plight and we make sure that we help wherever we can. And I think Salaam Media has gone a very long way in contributing to uplifting communities across South Africa and also other parts of the world.
Most definitely. Yusuf, we actually wanted to know from you if people would like to donate and, of course, join you and support you in what you're doing at this present moment, how do they get a hold of you?
The best is to go onto social media. My Twitter account, @Abramji, @Abramje, is the best way to find my my pinned tweet with all the SNF banking accounts. If any organization that wants to donate cash or kind to the Operation COVID Fund, you're welcome to WhatsApp me on 082-44-14203. I'll repeat it, Nafisa. WhatsApp me on 082-44-14203. I'll be able to give you the banking details and the delivery address for the food donations and the essential items like soaps and sanitizers. Again, unfortunately, we can't help everyone who wants a food pack. So if anyone wants a food pack in Gauteng, my best advice is please email the Social Development Department and I'll give you the email address. It's support@gauteng.gov.za. support@gauteng.gov.za. If you are in need of a food pack, I can't guarantee that a food pack will be given to you. You can only try. But again, if you need a food pack and you're in desperate need, contact one of your local charities. Hopefully, they'll be able to assist you wherever they can because many of our communities have credible charities that are working very, very hard. But again, if anyone wants the banking details for SENF, it's on the @Abramji Twitter account or the SENZEF on Facebook. The South African National Zakat Fund is also on Facebook. All the details are on there. Alternatively, the NPOs or the charities or companies or manufacturers who want to donate, you are welcome to WhatsApp me and I'll put you in touch with the right people.
Yes, and that's what it's all about, is actually going into those impoverished areas, especially through this difficult time and helping those people, because I think we're the only ones that can reach out to them. So I'm saying it's very important for us to just give, give, and not expect to receive. So it's very important, Yusuf. I think you'd agree with me.
Let's do it from the bottom of our hearts. You know, and I know a lot of people are negative. Your show is about positivity, Nafisa. Let's be positive. Let's have hope. Let's keep on praying. Inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will ease the difficulty that the Ummah is going through. And throughout the world, I think people are going through a very difficult time. In the Middle East, we know that the COVID rates are going up. And really, we have to do much more to see how we can help people in need. And we're calling on everyone to remember the people that are affected by the COVID virus. We make dua that Allah protect us from the COVID virus. And we make dua that people that are in distress, whether they need food, whether they need medical attention, that we ease them and Allah ease them of the suffering. And we have a moral and a civic duty to see how we can help them in a very small way that may be.
Oh, most definitely. Tell me, what last message do you have before you go? Something positive for our message, for all our listeners.
you know, there'll always be a positive outcome out of the coronavirus. Whether the world will be the same after the 21-day or 2-month or 3-month lockdown, no one knows. But I think there's a lot of lessons here. I think the lessons for everyone is keep on praying, get closer to your Creator, stay at home, follow the rules, follow the regulations, and in two words, do good.
Oh, most definitely. And Yusuf, we are running out of time, but I have a closing monologue for you. And this is actually in reference to all the wonderful people out there that are making differences, including all our caregivers and our health workers and people like yourself, Yusuf, and your team and all the other teams from all the different foundations as such. And this is what I want to say. The best of people are those that bring most benefit to the rest of mankind. And this was said by our beloved Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I couldn't have said it better, because really, honestly speaking, it's not an easy task. And we commend all of you for all the efforts that are going out there. As you were saying, it's not enough, but I think a little goes a long way. So if each one of us pulls together, we definitely will help make South Africa a better place.
You couldn't have put it more eloquently. Jazakallah for that, Sister Nafisa. And thank you for the good work that you are doing. And thank you again to our listeners and our viewers. Again, please, 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 I beg you, if you can spare a rand or two, donate to a credible charity, donate to the cause. Let's have the people in need. Let's continue to make a difference. And, you know, there are international renowned leadership principles. One of the principles says always model the way. We all have to model the way. Let's be an example to other people, and let's show the fellow South African citizens and our brothers and sisters across the world that we care, that our religion teaches us to be charitable, and let's continue to do good in our communities, inshallah.
Most definitely. And I think we are going to be those role models and examples for everybody else. So thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate you actually taking the time out to have this conversation with us. And of course, giving us some food for thought and some words of inspiration.
Thank you very much, Nafisa. Thank you for the opportunity. And thank you to our media platform, Salaam Media, for the opportunity and the great work again that you and your team, together with the entire management of Salaam Media, is doing. And inshallah, you know, we just keep on praying that we get out of this difficult situation with speed, and let's again pay tribute to the many unsung heroes and heroines out there, people that are serving their communities. Thank you for the opportunity. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Amin wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and do stay safe. From myself, Nafisa Dango, and the team, all we say is assalamu alaikum. Please take care, do wear those masks, and don't stop giving.